Hello, everyone. We are hosts from Common Ground Discourse. My name is Shane Swor.
Godspeed, I'm Brother Kenneth.
Since we've launched our channel, we've had questions come in from different areas, and we figured that it would be a good idea to create another list of videos that addresses these questions insofar as they're at a manageable level. It allows us to kind of interact with the audience and again, it displays the bigger message of getting everyone involved.
You know? It's discourse, after all.
Yeah, exactly. Disagree with us.
Right.
We've challenged you. All right, so these questions, we actually had several come in from one subscriber, Dave. This is coming from, I think it's Indonesia. Yeah, Indonesia. And so we'll jump right into it. The first question, and by the way, I guess I should say, this comes from our first episode when we were defining roles.
Right.
He had posed these questions. And so they were quite big. So we've condensed them for the sake of brevity, and so we can get into the answers. First question was, on both sides, you have good and bad people. You have those of faith and believers who are good and bad, or who do good things or bad things. And you have those who are non-believers or don't believe in God, who do good and bad things. And his question is, what fails a man's faith in religion in the first place? What's causing millions to fall out of religion? And I think it might be appropriate for me to start this off since I've gone through that path. I think it differs to each their own. You have some people who, and this isn't answering the question, but some people who are just born into a secular family. They never experience religion. They have no reason to have faith to start off with, simply because it's just what their parents believe or lack of belief in. I'd say, again, if we go back to the stage theory that we just covered with Fowler, it could be just questioning against the institution. You might experience something that you don't agree with that kind of shakes your foundations with how you've been brought up, and then you start looking for maybe areas of doubt or the areas of doubt that are existing you can't find answers to, so you fall out of faith that way. I don't think that the conversion from or the path from faith would cause an individual to do bad things in the name of leaving that faith. Mm-hmm. They might just be distressed or their meaning for life being behind them might put them through a state where they're not well. I don't think that's the case for everyone, and it might be just the case for very few, because I think that transition can be exciting.
If we put our Fowler hat on,
yeah,
the response to this question would actually differ depending on what stage you're in.
That's true.
If you're a stage 4 or stage 5 and you're looking back at it, why do you lose faith? Well, stage 4 would say, because it didn't take my considerations truly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my personal experience was different from what the church was teaching, and the church wouldn't bend.
Yeah.
So I went on my own. If you're stage 5, then it's the same reflection. The institution was not defining what the personal experience was. But if it's a stage 3 answering this question, why do people lose faith? It's because they question too much, mm-hmm. or they didn't have strong enough faith. Mm-hmm. Stage 3 looking at stage 4 sees a backslider. Stage 3 looking at stage 5 sees a heretic.
Right.
So if a stage 3 were to look at this, or even stage 2, it's because they didn't keep on keeping on.
Right.
They didn't have the strong enough faith. They didn't have the trust that would allow for this faith. But for those that are stage 4 or stage 5 and are looking back at that split, I think from a more objective point of view, it's when the religion can no longer adequately answer or at least justify your experience with the church's teachings.
Mm-hmm.
If there's too much of a dissonance between what the church offers and what you are experiencing in your need, or even your relationship with others,
mm-hmm.
then eventually, if your cognitive dissonance will not finally bow to the institution, then you will break.
Okay.
And that's the point where, whether it's the language the church is using, for instance, if you have matured, if you are stage 3 and you are in a stage 2 church, the stage 2 church is strictly a literal interpretation of scripture, and stage 3 has started to use and appreciate allegory, not to the extent that stage 5 would be, but at least to begin to see something outside of that, then you no longer fit in that church.
Mm-hmm.
And if you think the church you are in defines all of religion, to leave that church is to leave religion, fortuity of God, if that church is God or represents God. So it just depends on how disparate you are, how far apart you are from the stage of the church that you're in.
Yes. And, you know, the question is kind of a path. You have the question of, like, what causes one to lose faith in religion? And then you have that almost the philosophical approach to, you know, you have people doing good and bad things, you know, regardless of what they believe in. But I think ultimately you're going to have good people and you're going to have bad people. What they believe in is just circumstantial. You know, again, no one would say that, or any rational person would say that Stalin did what he did for the sake of atheism. That wasn't his driving point. He had an alternative agenda.
Right.
It just so happened that he was. Right. And we can point to several other things where people of faith do it. I think the atheist camp is very quick to point to religion and say, oh, they're going crazy because of their religion. If it weren't for that, they would be a good person. But I think that can be a little fallacious. You have to look at the individual and understand where they're coming from. That's not to say that I don't think that religion encourages people to do things that are questionable. When we look at, especially if we're going to look at the moral landscape of what's good and bad and contributes to human well-being,
right.
I think that ideas that we don't question, I don't want to just say religion, the ideas that we don't question can cause us to do bad things. So I hope that answers
the question. And one other, from the religious standpoint, I would say, our subscriber specifically asked, what causes millions to lose faith? Flat out. Mm-hmm. Why do they lose? For all that I said between its stages, the other part is, if the church doesn't feed you anymore, you're not going to go back to the buffet, as it were. And there are, within theological circles and pastoral circles, there's a huge debate as to what is the purpose of church. Why do people come to church? Why are millennials leaving? Why do we have new emergent churches? Why do we have traditional churches? Is there validity, or is there applicability? Is there a benefit to chant and old liturgical practices, or is everything new age? It is a huge conversation, but when it comes down to it, in our conversations, the heart of it is, someone's going to leave if they're not being fed. Mm-hmm. Is the church giving you what you need to be more of who you want to be and can be? Mm-hmm. And that's a tricky subject, because you can have feel-good churches that will justify everything you do, especially very self-centered activity, which I think we're going to cover in one of the other questions. But the other part is the church challenging you to grow. Is it challenging you in a way that will allow you to grow comfortably, or is it pushing you too hard? Because you can go too far on that.
Right.
But the essence is, before you ever start questioning, is there a God, before you leave a church, I think the real premise is, am I getting what I need? Is there a reason I'm going to show up on a Sunday? Do I show up to this Bible study? Do I show up to the Sabbath? Why do I do it? If I'm getting something out of it, then I'm going to keep doing it. Even if it feels uncomfortable, if it's done pastorally to challenge me, I know I'm still growing.
Yeah, there's something there that's reinforcing the behavior of attendance or thought. I think the simple, quick, and easy answer for me is, it just depends on the individual. If you ask, why are millions losing faith? I think in the new atheist camp, when you have foundations for reason and science, it might just be the fact that some people can't reconcile those two.
Right.
And it's argued that it can't be reconciled. Mm-hmm. I haven't spent enough time on it to say certainly what I think about it. I think right now, if you were to ask me, I think they are irreconcilable. There are aspects of religion that just can't carry that over to science. And I think when we look on a sense of theology, where you're taking religion and philosophy and you're contemplating on the lessons you can learn, then I think it stays in the realm of philosophy. No one would say, I think, you know, that can philosophical thought be quantified into something that's a study of science?
Right.
Can't do that. That's getting off topic. Anyway, I'd like to move on to question two. Is there a religion that could benefit our lives through its practices? The point that he makes here is, if it's only for assurance and doesn't change our perspective, religion becomes unnecessary because philosophy does a better job. such as Confucius. I'll leave this to you. I think you can answer this a little. You can answer this better than I can.
Right. So is there a religion, first off, is there a religion that could benefit our lives through its practices? Why do we have religion, not philosophy?
Why do we choose religion and not go to philosophy?
And it's funny that he mentions Confucius, because when I was getting my undergraduate in doing world comparative religions, one of them was Confucianism. And absolutely loved that class. But our teacher pointed out that Confucius mentions heaven, which is Tian in Chinese. He only mentions it twice in all of the analects. Confucius. And he qualified it more as a humanistic value system, which is why Confucianism typically falls under philosophy as opposed to religion. And in Eastern cultures, they typically pair Taoism as the religious side, Confucianism as the secular side. That brings it together. But the question at his heart is, why choose religion to make you better? And he asks, is there a religion? Is there a specific religion? And I would say any religion that you have, any of the major religions, qualify that one, any of the major religions could do that. Any of them can, as he says, benefit your life through its practice. Your question is, what is a benefit? Is it allowing you a better understanding of yourself? Every major religion can do that. There's an aspect of every religion that is introspective and self-challenging that allows you to grow. Does it help you relate to others? Absolutely. Every single major religion has an aspect that talks about interpersonal relationship. Mm-hmm. Is there a connection? Is there something that allows you a connection to more cosmic questions? Why am I here? Where did I come from? What is my purpose? Is there something that gives us, if not assurance, at least a direction to operate in that? Well, absolutely. These are fundamental questions that every human being would have, most do. The problem is, to nail down a single religion from a contemplative, and that's where, as we said in Fowler's Stages of Faith, when you're at stage 4 and stage 5, you start seeing the blending, or the blurring of lines. So I'm comfortable saying there are other religions that are just as accessible as this. But when you say there's one religion that has one answer, I think that's when you start going down a very narrow and dead-end rabbit hole. If you say it's only Christianity that is the truth, and this is where I would be put in the heretical side, mm-hmm. thank you very much. but so is Jesus, and I'm okay with being in a heretic basket with him. But the idea that if it's only one answer and one singular interpretation of that answer, and that's the rabbit hole, the slippery slope, that if it can only be one religion, then it can be only one interpretation of that religion. And once you get down to one denomination, then it's only one interpretation within that denomination. I mean, it's such a narrow view for something that ultimately we can't understand. So to say that there's one answer, I'm not going to go that way. Can't go that way. The human history itself is way too diverse. Can a religion benefit us more than philosophy? To that, I say yes.
Okay.
Because for me, philosophy is more the secularist idea. How do I relate to other people? How do I present? How do I logically think about myself? Et cetera, et cetera. But theology takes it one step further, and this is the spiritual side. This is the side where non-theists deviate. Obviously, mm-hmm. I start talking about spiritual matters, and that's, I imagine, where you start rolling your eyes. But for me, within my own practice, and this is where he says, within our practices, with a contemplative practice, centering prayer, rosaries, etc., there is an experience I have in that centering that connects me, I feel, to something bigger than myself. And if you look at yoga within Hinduism, it's curious because yoga is called the science of yoga, because following the same principles, it is an experience that justifies the practice. They actually look at it going, no, this does connect me to something bigger than I am. This experience is my divine. And you practice it. If this practice doesn't work, then you throw it out, because it isn't justifying, it is not giving you what it's supposed to, therefore it is a fruitless practice. Get rid of it. Similar with, now we don't use the science language that we do, but the similar practice within Christianity, centering prayer will do this, rosaries will do this. And I get more out of that than I do philosophy. I love philosophy. You know, I sit down with Descartes, I sit down with Voltaire. I don't even know if you can see him on camera, but we've got a bust of creepy Voltaire up there looking down upon us from on high, right next to Goethe and his philosophy, actually. But that question of divine outside of myself isn't in philosophy. I don't find in philosophy. And that's why, and that drives my practices. Do I experience the divine in you that I've experienced in me? And that becomes my compass. And I don't get that out of philosophy.
I have plenty of comments. But I think for the sake of not getting too far off or just addressing the question, again, I know if we really wanted to discuss this, we could spend an hour easily on each question. But for the sake of brevity, we'll move on to the next. Third question is, why does calamity exist in devoutness, such as Job in the Old Testament? Bad things happen to good people. Is the only human logic or logic that transcends us, such as God's? So I think what we're trying to say here is that can we understand only our logic, or should we at least address that there's a logic from a higher power?
Right.
And is that why we experience calamity? And is it good to experience calamity in religion?
Right.
And I'd want to open with a thought here that when we look at things that happen to us, I think we put them in categories of good and bad. Mm-hmm. And since we like to think of God or the Christian God, and I'm only using one example among the many examples of gods out there, but I'd like just to speak on the Christian God because it's where I'm coming from, and I think it's the main source of focus when atheists attack God,
right,
et cetera. But we look at that. When something good happens, many are quick to say, oh, God is good, God is great, God is kind and just. But when something bad happens, well, now he's mysterious. We don't say, oh, that was probably not good for God. I think it's because we have created this idea that by default, whatever God does is just willed into goodness. He's exempt from critique. And so we might experience calamity when we're questioning that. And it's a serious topic to think about, because if you are brought up, or if you yourself truly believe that this deity of your religion does nothing but good and loves you, you get troubled when you see things like malaria in children and the catastrophes that happen that cause many good people to die,
right,
or the endless amount of things that I think we can point to people acting on behalf of religion or just natural disasters. God has an ultimate plan. Why does this happen? Why does he project suffering onto those reciprocate love to, or try to, worship. Anyways, I'd like to, you know, let's turn it over to you.
So, yeah, I mean, and he mentions Job, which is probably one of the most misinterpreted, misquoted, if you will, books in the Bible when it comes to suffering. Because a lot of people talk about the patience of Job. You know, if you're good in your faith, then you will endure the way Job did. And the fact is, if you actually read the book of Job, he kvetches and argues with God all the time. And all of his friends are denigrating him, but even Job reaches the end of his tether and looks to God and goes, WTF. At which point God looks down and says, you, peon, you were not here when I created the Leviathan. Mm-hmm. When I did all of this, you weren't there. And that goes back to the incomprehensibility of God that you mentioned. Mm-hmm. So that's just a quick soapbox about using Job in your language. But when you talk about the suffering of God, this is something I've actually preached a lot on.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm careful to do so, because this, you have to be very sensitive as to where someone is in their stages of faith for this one.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're stage two or you're stage three, you're still anthropomorphizing God at this point. And it's a very human tendency to say this is good or bad. And if it's a human tendency, then that's what you were projecting onto God. But God has a plan. That God is directed and directive for what the world is doing. And I'm part of that. God is bigger than me. so I don't need to question where I am in that mood. And yet on the other side, we say God is personal and is with me in all that I do. So you inherently create, at some point, a contradiction. God either loves me and wants me to be happy, and I can somehow go through the mental hoop that when something bad happens to me, it's part of God's plan, and I just need to acquiesce to that. Or if we agree that God has my personal interest at heart and something bad happens to me, the other side of that is God is a manipulative bastard.
Mm-hmm.
It creates a conundrum.
We've heard it, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. But if I reflect back to Tillich's definition of God, or faith rather, remember, faith is the object of ultimate concern.
Mm-hmm.
You have a crisis of faith when that ultimate concern, whatever you think is ultimate, is no longer ultimate, because you found a limit. The reason doubt is so crucial for Tillich's faith is because doubt keeps pushing you. If you have created an image of God that does not allow a justifiable experience of your suffering or someone else's suffering, and cannot reconcile with your other definition, then you've reached the cognitive dissonance that's going to force an impact. The image of God, that little box you put him in, isn't big enough. And you either break open the box and find God outside of it, or, going back to his first question, why do we lose faith? Well, if my definition of God was too limited, and now God no longer fits in that definition, I'm just going to get rid of my belief in God altogether. So, for me, and the reason I said I preach on this carefully, is that when I talk about God, I look at a God of presence, not providence. It's two very distinct ways. If it's a God of providence, it's a God that has a plan. It's a God that is directing us, a God that is very active in what we do. So that God is responsible for all things that happen. He becomes the ultimate puppet master. And that isn't not a derogatory term, but that he is specifically manipulating it. But a God of presence is one that means whatever happens, as it happens, because that is simply the way the world is working. God isn't here to make the world move from one moment to the next. God is here for us to find in that moment to the next. God is an activity, an action. God is a presence that we find and connect to, so that the suffering that will inevitably happen is something I can survive spiritually, because I know God is with me in it. God doesn't necessarily cause the suffering. God doesn't necessarily prevent the suffering. It's not for God to manipulate the world. It's for me to find God in the aspect, in spite of the world.
Yeah, well, then God becomes a completely different definition of what millions of people see him to be. Someone who does have a direct hand. And I think, you know, when I was watching, and I shared with you not too long ago, the position that Hitchens was taking against his brother. Anyways, it dawned on me, I think that the arguments that atheists have so aggressively are normally targeted towards stage two thinkers,
yeah.
Which I think that falls in line with your lexicon of bullying, that you have someone who is not significantly higher, but of, I think in many cases, superior intellect, and has such a way with words to really degrade the thoughts and the perspectives of those who are trying to understand God in their journey in faith. And there's only so much I think I can relate to as an atheist for those on their path of faith, but because I've experienced it, I think I can see where they're coming from.
Logically speaking, educating your audience.
Yeah.
That's called a straw man argument.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
And that's what Hitchens and Dawkins typically do, is they go after the anthropomorphic view of God,
mm-hmm.
which for anyone beyond stage two or stage three is the weakest view of God.
Well, and that's true, but I think the reason why is because it's just so present.
It is.
It's right. Unfortunate. Well, you know, I'll say it. It's unfortunate that we don't have more stage three, four thinkers or people who practice religion.
Well, stage four, stage five.
Yeah, stage four. But even, like, I think there are so many kind of in that.
Stuck in a literal anthropomorphic stage two. Yeah, true.
Yes. Where is that arc? It's still here somewhere. We just haven't found it. It is a shame that there aren't more. And it's, you know, it's no one's position to, like you said, force the progression. But my point is I think that they do that because they see it, and I think in certain circumstances we could both agree that it is threatening to progress. And not to get too far off topic, but just going on to when you constantly face doubt. That is what I think science is first and foremost. Science does strive to prove what we know or what we can understand about the universe, but the main principle in that is that everyone in the scientific community is focused on proving each other wrong.
Right.
It's a system that's built on, more so than anything, oh, you think you know what you found, right? Well, let me show you that you're wrong. And where a sacred belief like religion steps into that boxing ring, they then finally understand what every other scientist has to go through. And it's a pain in the ass. It really is. And that's another reason why I think inserting the teachings of creationism in the science classes is ridiculous. But we're starting to see why the pushback is necessary. It's just a process of science. Not that this has anything to do with Calamity. I know it was a tangent, but I felt like I wanted to bring it up. So to sum it up, it's good, you would say, to experience that calamity as a result of doubt and questioning or redefining your view of God.
I think when he talks about calamity here, he's talking about why do bad things happen to good people, you know, that kind of thing.
But it obviously questions, like, why would it happen?
And my response is, when you look at it, bad things happen to good people because it's life.
Yeah.
Life is never going to be perfect.
Yeah.
You know, life is struggle. Mm-hmm. You know, to borrow from the Buddhists, you know, life is nothing but that struggle and that pain. But the idea that God's going to give us a perfect life and everything's going to be hunky-dory, I think that misrepresents what life is.
Mm-hmm.
And it misrepresents what God is supposed to be for us. God isn't supposed to be the puppeteer that's going to make everything happy if we do everything good. Because then it brings up the whole question. Well, if God is in charge of making bad things happen, he's either abusive because I have been good and still wound up with a bad consequence, or there's something I did that was wrong I don't even know about. And that's when you start getting into, you know, the justification in Eastern philosophies or Eastern religions. The whole idea of karma coming around on the wheel, bad things happening now because
something
in another life.
Yes, I agree. I mean, life is life. Terrible, horrible things happen. And I think that can cause those to question their faith. So we'll move on to the next. In some Christian denominations, their path to salvation breeds intolerance or resentment towards those who do not see a similar message. As a result, should Christians look to redefine or re-examine their salvation message? So the behavior of resentment is normally looked down upon or frowned upon, I think, in a community of Christians who have intolerance for unbelievers. But isn't creating life order by defining good and wrong as meant by God in an understandable way the essence of religion?
So where do we define right and wrong?
So should Christians two parts. Should Christians redefine their salvation message as to make the unbelievers more tolerable in their lives? Right. I think is what he's getting at here. And questioning right and wrong. So I'll have you start with this one.
So if we use, going back to Fowler, this is an easy benchmark as to why people do what they do as far as the resentment and narrow views. Why do they become so narrow? Why do they become so insular? Well, that's the definition of stage two and stage three, because you're defined by institutions. But moving out of just the academic view of why they operate that way, from a more pastoral point of view, we are human. We are tribal by nature. We are defined by who is in and who is out. Our very biology is based off of the family that will protect us versus the family outside that wants to take our resources. Whether that resource is physical food or that resource is our salvation, you know, it's something I need. And I think that aspect of our biology, religions at their best call us to go beyond. When Jesus said, I've come to give you life that you might live life fully, the way I interpret that is that we can live outside of our animal needs, that we can actually become human, not animal. Mm-hmm. But to his question about this resentment, the reason behind it is that if you are fundamentalist in your makeup, if you're fundamentalist or orthodox, if you're orthodox, you're basing your faith on one definition of God. And if you have constructed God on an answer, you have the answer to God as the foundation of your faith. It's a very small foundation, and your faith is built all on top of that singular answer. Anything that questions that answer, that definition of God, doesn't just threaten your answer. It threatens everything that you built on top of it. So it makes sense why people that are more fundamentalist in their faith, why the more fundamentalists react so violently, because they're threatened, and anger is a second response to fear. So if you're threatening that tiny little foundation, that singular answer of God, and everything they believe on top of it is now threatened, they're going to push back. And it doesn't even have to be actively questioning it. The fact that an alternative exists in religion calls into question the validity of their own. And that's why they'll attack others. The alternative to that is, rather than finding God in the question, do you find God, or finding God in the answer, do you find God in question? And that's where the contemplative and the higher stages come in. If I find God in the process of looking, as opposed to finding God in an answer and then hinging everything on that, there will be infinite numbers of questions. And as soon as I have an answer for God, I realize God is too big for that answer. So I'm going to throw out the answer and keep looking for God in the bigger side. To his question, should we have religions that, you know, look bigger than what they are? Mm-hmm. Something bigger than I have the only answer? I would say absolutely. And for many, and I have theological colleagues that would push back against that, that say, no, you shouldn't expect religions to move beyond where they are. But no, if the religion is damaging to others because it is so narrow and so insular, then we have a responsibility within our own religious practice to hold each other accountable. Whether it is Christian to Christian or Christian across denomination, I mean, I would expect a Sufi to hold me accountable for my faith. And for us to have that dialogue, that if we are to be religious, then we need to look at each other and go, there is a limit that you have hit that is inappropriate. Let's work on that.
All right. You know, I have little to comment on this. My answer would just be, sure. I mean, if you feel that it's necessary to redefine your message of salvation as to be more tolerable to your fellow man and woman who would disagree with you, I don't see how that could be a bad thing. I don't see how that could be a wrong move. And again, I'm not sure what denomination that Dave practices here, but I would hope that if whatever penalty you get for not practicing that salvation, you're penalized for accepting the fellow heretic, that whatever deity you're following would at least respect you for being honest and kind rather than 100% obedient. But again, it depends on what God you're greeted by. Cool. So moving on to the next final question here. In some Christian denominations, you have an institution gathering money for their own use and expense. Shouldn't it be obvious to us, the non-believers, that it's nonsense, that it doesn't tie into that religion? The institution's using money for lavish spending and not giving back to the world with what is gained in offerings. For many, and I suspect that he's speaking of fellow Christians, that this conduct goes against common sense of thinking. And Dave goes to say that he thinks it's bad practices of money handling have destroyed what Christianity is, or the perspective of Christianity. I think I'll start with saying that I think that any atheist or non-believer seeing that happening would say that that particular institution is doing wrong, and they're almost a hypocrite for doing so. And when you speak on common sense about how that goes against what a religion should be. Maybe it isn't so common, since so many millions of people are willing to hand over that to what appears to be taking advantage of those in attendance. But as we were preparing for this, I know you said that there's a factor of faith that goes into that. The act of giving money is being faithful, no matter what happens to it, no matter how it's handled or what it goes towards, even if the person preaching that your wealth be handed unto them, that is an act of God. Regardless, that he then takes that and lives a lifestyle of wealth and luxury.
Right.
Who else could we be talking about? I'm gonna have you say that.
Right? Yeah, there's some easy pot shots in this one.
Yeah.
So, to answer his, quite simply, to answer his questions, or to reiterate, he thinks that bad practice of money handling has destroyed Christianity. And I would say, I wouldn't say that is the sole reason that Christianity is, or any religion really, is waning. Is it one of the leading causes for people leaving Christianity? I would say so. It's somewhat embarrassing, really. And
not to interrupt, that would be interesting to really look at. Like, what are the statistics on conversion from that, which would, if we could verify it, would answer his first question. So many millions of people leaving it because the first religion that they were introduced to was effectively stealing from them. Stealing that it was dishonest gathering.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Continue. You know, when people have discussed this in our clerical or theological circles, one of the things that are often they'll point out is that millennials can smell BS a mile away. And it's a generational thing. We are so inundated with pathos and ethos as far as advertising goes that, we've grown accustomed to it and we've grown a thick skin to it. We're not taken in by it. And when you have a church that keeps talking about helping those out, loving your brother, making sure to help the poor, because you hear it in the gospel. It says, be with the one in jail, be with the poor on the street. And then you see the pastor that has the $2.4 million house or more. You begin to wonder, how does that really justify itself? And it's easy to see that those are difficult to put hand in hand. But it goes back to the interpretation of the pastor towards his flock. If the pastor is actually up front and saying, as I told you, if they say giving money is the important thing, not where the money goes, but that you are sacrificing and giving money, that's what God wants, and you are now a better person for it, it doesn't matter where the money goes. And they can accumulate as much wealth as they want, and they're actually being genuine and honest to what they do. If you look at the prosperity gospel, and I'm going to stop being unbiased at this point. If you look at the absurdity of the prosperity gospel, because God's going to reward you with money because somehow God is doling out wealth according to your goodness. And when I get to Kohlberg's stages of morality, if you are going on the basis of reward, that's stage one. Stage one and stage two morality right there. But, if that's the basis, God's going to reward me, and proof of my goodness is the amount of wealth that I get. That kind of warps the whole message. And I think the rest of the world is looking at that and seeing it. And has an issue with it. All the same, it's those that accumulate wealth and feed into the human desire to be bigger and better than who they are. That if you have a church entirely based off of poverty, as we have with the Franciscans, then no one's going to really want to do that because it's not human nature. So for the sake of bringing people into a church in order to lead them and better them as a community, there's got to be a halfway point. Are you responsible with your money? That's not a religious question. That's a human question. If you were in a business, I would expect you to be responsible with your money. And that's, we see the huge pushback with Wall Street and the banks. When you see the CEOs that have just pillaged their clients and then walk away with these $1 million pension plans. Are you responsible with your money? Well, I'm going to take my business elsewhere. The exact same consumerist model is being used for churches now. And this, from a strictly insular, from us on the theist side, when we hear the pushback from non-theists, I think we need to take that very seriously. That if they see the obvious hypocrisy that is going on, that should be a wake-up call for us to say, we can't do it the way we used to. We do actually need to look at what we are doing, because a lot of this they've just inherited. It's the way it's always been done. And if it's a system they can take advantage of, they're going to take advantage of it. It's human nature. But it takes effort to hold ourselves accountable. Even as an Episcopalian, you know, I look at the salaries of some of our bishops and I find it embarrassing. I look at the expense accounts of some of our parishes and it's more money than I'll ever know. And what do they do with it? Right. That's always the question. And the shift has been in the old practice of the church, you raise money and money spent on the church is to the glory of God, because it will be not just for that generation, but it's hereditary to the next generation. You are accumulating that wealth so others will appreciate it as they worship down the road. There's been far too much of a cultural shift now to hold that strictly accountable. We can't have that practice because people don't see it that way.
I hope that we've been able to address each, but I think we have addressed each question there.
I want to throw it at you so you have a chance to speak. Sure. much of this is the religious side, so I guess.
I'm trying to hurry it up because I'm almost out of wine, and that's a crime right there.
My tea, it's almost there. Yeah. For the last one, a lot of the pushback I hear from a lot of my non-theist friends, so many of the Facebook posts.
Okay.
I see. If you're talking about the deficit that's in America, and we talk about these corporate people, these businesses and these wealthy people that have offshore holdings, so they're tax exempt.
Mm.
I have so many of my non-theist friends look at churches and say, well, if you want money, why don't you look at these institutions that are tax exempt? When you have a pastor that just, and true life story, here I am in Atlanta, 10 years ago, and a friend of mine who has a house in one of these condo towers in Atlanta, he has a new neighbor coming into the penthouse who is a pastor. The church has just purchased for said pastor the $1.8 million penthouse one, because that's what pastor needs. Mm-hmm. And that's tax exempt because it's the church property. It is now the house allowance, as it falls to the church. We talk about the responsibility of money. The idea behind tax exemption is that a church uses its money to better the society, the governance of the civilization around it. What are your thoughts?
So the question being, I guess let's work it in reverse. Yeah.
Do you think churches are even capable of managing that money correctly enough in order to earn that tax exemption?
I mean, I think probably they are. But the question really comes, are they? Are they actually doing it? And at scale, if you're going to be tax exempt from something, then do at least conduct your behavior in a way that's aligned with what you're going to do. Otherwise, what happens? And I think I should start this off by saying I wish I knew a little bit more about economics and how all that worked to do your question justice. Mm-hmm. But I guess I can offer my opinion with this here. I think that they're capable of doing it. I just don't know if they are. Mm-hmm. And I haven't really looked too much into it. And then I guess the first part, is that the pushback that you get from your atheist colleagues, other atheist colleagues? Are they claiming that to deter, like, you know, you have these corporations who have massive amounts of money offered in places they can't be taxed.
Right.
And they point to the church. That's their resolution. Do I think that that's sensible? I think it's an easy target.
Yeah.
And many atheists do that because, you have your angry or aggressive atheists that are very quick to point a lot of blame towards the church and not really look at, okay, what is the big problem here? In comparison, how much money is offshore as a result of the way that corporations are conducting their behavior versus the church? I mean, I don't know what that number looks like. It would be interesting to investigate. I think that both areas could do a little bit better about how they decide to dodge taxes.
Right.
I'm not sure if that's a good way to address that, what my thoughts are on it. I think it's easy for atheists to attack a church because of everything else that they attack them for. And if there's one more point on the scale that they can point to in terms of now become the tax problem.
Right.
There's one more thing the church is doing that is contributing towards unfairness or unbalance. So, I'd have to say, I'd love to answer it more eloquently. I just don't know much about, not as much about economics as I should to answer that. So, maybe we can have somebody on the panel. Anyways, I think it's this would sum up our Ask Us Anything episode. We'll make a completely different list. As this isn't to be confused with the sequence of episodes that we have with the discourse. We just, again, wanted to be able to answer these questions, which I think are complex, and it's not necessary, or it's not really a native language to just list a comment response from us on YouTube. No one would sit down and read that. Yes, we hope to do this more. And again, we encourage you to ask us questions, and we would respond in the same way with future inquiries. So we'll see you next time. Thank you.
Godspeed.